Hey everybody, welcome to Woodworking Wisdom. My name's Colwin Way, and today we have Steph behind the cameras and doing all the trickery with the questions and things like that. So if you have any questions, which I really, really hope you do, then put them in the chat and Steph's going to be asking them. Hopefully I'll be answering them if I can. Today is all about, well, it's a Q&A really. It's a question and answer session. Really, I want to look at the chucks, and more importantly, I'm looking at the new Essential SK88. I want to do it a little bit of an explanation as to what it is. We've launched this chuck within the last couple of weeks, and there's an awful lot of talk about it on social media. I've seen a few forums going crazy about it, and there's all sorts of speculation as to why we've done it and things like that. The simple fact is, we wanted a chuck that we could offer at a lower price to fit the workshop range, really. If you buy one of the cheaper benchtop machines, then if you go straight to an SK114, first to start with, it's a lot bigger than the lathe itself, and you know it carries a price tag being stainless steel and all those things that come with that. A chuck of that prestige. So what we've done is we've made a smaller chuck, so less materials, and we've made it from not stainless steel but EN1A, so a cheaper steel for us. All the costs and manufacturing is down. And remember that this is a UK made chuck. 100 yards across the road here is where they're made. So this is our answer to that price band and that lathe range. The other thing I thought of, which for me is really quite useful, if I want to add more chucks to my range of chucks rather than change jaws, again, it's another affordable way of doing that rather than having to save up for as long. I can you know, have maybe a couple of these chucks. There are a different range of jaws or a smaller range of jaws for them. So I couldn't use my 114 jaws on these, for instance, because there'd just be no movement to the chuck. So there are a range of jaws with it, and I'm going to show you all of them, but we're going to start with the actual kit itself. You can buy this in two options. You can buy the chuck itself, and I'm going to be guided by you, Steph. So where's the best place to show these? On the bench or in the bench? So look, we've got this option. So that is the chuck package. So there we are. You can see there that we've got the actual chuck itself. We've also got faceplate ring, and there's a slightly redesigned screw chuck for this chuck itself. This particular one is a 33 by 3.5, and just while we're talking thread sizes, let me just go over. You're going to see me darting down to a notepad. I've just written as many bits of info as I can. So thread sizes available for this chuck is 1 inch 8, 3/4 by 16, 1 1/4 by 8, an M30 by 3.5, and an M33 by 3.5. Yes, question, sorry.
Yes, we've got a question from Frederick. He's asking, does the chuck and jaws key fit the SK80?
Absolutely, it is the same key. Wait, you direct me, Steph Director. There we are. So it's the same key. So I would take that straight out. The SK80, the SK, the old style SK100. It is the same chuck key. So no difference there.
And the jaws are the same.
And the jaws. Yeah, the jaws, obviously, the old SK80 had stainless steel jaws. They will still fit this one. Likewise, these will fit the old SK80 as well. So there's no problem there. They will retrofit. But also, these smaller jaws I'm about to show you will also fit the SK100 and the 114. So just think of it this way, because all of these numbers are going to get really, really confusing. Think of it this way. You can use smaller jaws on a bigger chuck, but not the other way around, really. That's the way I like to look at it. You can, you know, and you can, there are a few little gray areas, but if you're really unsure, stick to that analogy, and then that sort of works. You will see me mixing around regularly, but that's a good way to look at it. So the kit, like I said, there's the box for the kit. It has the chuck itself. It has the E-jaws, so a little gap we hadn't filled before, the E-jaws. Basically, it's similar to the C-jaws. However, we still have the dovetail on the outside, but we also now have a dovetail on the inside. Okay, and I'll tell you what, that was a recommendation by the late, great John Jordan. He suggested we go with a dovetail on the outside. It's on the inside as well. So that was down to him that we come up with that one. So thank you, John. So there we are. The E-jaws come with that one. And already to fit that is a faceplate ring. So for your bowl turning, one option for your face, for your bowls. And then this slightly redesigned screw chuck. So it's a smaller piece of kit. Again, we're looking at ways of keeping the cost down for this chuck to make it available for the workshop range. And so a smaller material blank, and that you can see there has a dovetail here and a little locating square socket that when you put it inside the chuck rests in there nicely, all screwed up and made nice and tight. Now I'm going to turn a little bowl for you in a minute, just with this little package, just a little ash bowl, not going to sand it, but just to give you an idea of what that's used for. So that's one machine. That's the kit itself. But I want to just go over the other jaws. So we just start putting things to one side. Again, jaws come like this, and you'll notice this particular box here is the pen jaws. So now we have two jaws instead of the four. So this is industry, available in industry by other manufacturers. And they use two jaws. So we say, okay, a great way of being able to keep that price lowered for this range. So a nice little pen jaw there. Still works in exactly the same way, but smaller and available for that chuck. And then this is just another box I grabbed. This is one of my particular favorites. This is the deep grip jaws. So you can see exactly why they are made. So they're for holding bigger pieces, long stem goblets, if you want to have maximum security, hollow forms, that sort of thing. But one of the things I like about this over, and I don't like comparing against other manufacturers, but there are some direct comparisons here, and I've seen it recently on social media, the thickness of jaws here. So these may be a set of jaws for the SK88, the small chuck, but there's some meat in there. There's some good solid steel there, so you've got some good strength on that particular jaw. And just look at these miniature O'Donnells as well. Look at all that steel that's available there. So you've got some strength in these jaws, even though they are small. So look, we've mentioned the deep grip jaws. So there we are. We've got a dovetail on the very end and on the outside and internal as well. But it is a gripper jaw, essentially, designed to be holding full length. If you've got small jobs, absolutely, you can hold them on the dovetails. But we do have the ease if you want to have bigger pieces held on a dovetail. So that's the deep grip jaws. I mentioned also the O'Donnells. The O'Donnells are our personal favorites of many turners, including myself. The O'Donnells, obviously, first thought of by Mick O'Donnell up in Scotland, but his idea was to have a jaw that threw bowls and any work pieces away from the chuck so you could work around the back of them. Okay, so that's the O'Donnell jaws. Yes, let's stop for a breath and to answer some questions.
You're doing a lot of talking.
I'm talking
today.
I know.
It's a lot for you. Got a question from Alien Leader. I'm going to change one of the words because I think he's had a little spell check, but sorry he's late, but do the jaws come off like the 100?
They do. Now thank you for the question, because that's a perfect one. I've taken these two little screws out. Okay, so I've got two chucks here. Well, I did have two chucks, I've got one now, but I've taken the screw from the back of the safety jaw, so if I need to take those screws out, I can. They come fitted already, so pre-fit, and so you won't be able to undo the safety jaws unless you take that screw out. Okay, just the nice little safety feature. If you're new to turning, which we're aiming these at, that will stop the jaws from being accidentally unwound. So I've taken mine out just because I want to swap my jaws around regularly. You can still do that, but just make sure you understand that you've just got to take it out the back. And that little grub screw is located, if I wind this all the way in, show the camera, you should see a little hole. There's the grub screw hole, and that stops me from being able to unwind it fully. Okay, well, I've just taken that out for this demonstration. So yes,
not a question, but the gentleman woodturner thinks they look very dinky and cute.
Well, thank you.
Not you. Oh. The jaws.
No, they do. They're lovely little miniatures, and again, perfectly suited to this sort of thing. And that's why I personally like them to add to my range of SK100s and SK114s as well, because it will, you know, tackle those smaller jobs. And I'm really excited the fact that it's available for 33 and 3.5, which is all of my machines as well. But also the smaller threads, so 3/4/16 and the 1/8, which I've got on here. But they are sort of, I want to say miniatures. I don't mean miniatures, but they are a smaller version of what we do for the bigger chucks as well. So it's quite useful. Yes.
And the gentleman woodturner has come in with a question just then. As the chuck isn't stainless steel, would camellia oil be good for keeping it clean and working well?
Well done. Thank you. Thank you, Mark. Yes, perfect. Camellia oil is great. To me, any dry lube's quite good as well. So the Teflon sprays, they work well. Camellia oil. It's just like, so back in the day, our old chucks, precision chucks, it's like lathe beds, all of those things that are regular steel and not stainless, those have to be protected in some way. Well, I say they have to be protected in some way. I like to think that without protecting them, they develop their own patina. That's only true if you're using them constantly. If you're not, and you leave your workshop, say, for a week or a couple of weeks, you will have rust red or red rust and develop on that steel. So you do need to, either it needs to be used regularly or protected, like camellia oil. Light oils is what we go for.
So Jimby's asked, why do woodturners use 4-jaw chucks and engineers use 3-jaw chucks?
Well, woodturners are always correct and engineers aren't. That's the main reason.
That's very similar answers in the chat.
Is it? Yeah. We joke with my friend Robert, who used to run the engineering courses, and he always asks the same question. This is also independent over self-centering. For woodturners, we're not dealing in the accuracies that engineers are trying to deal in. We have moving material whenever we're clamping or expanding onto it. So the accuracy level for us is achievable through a 4-jaw self-centering. Most of the time we're holding circular pieces. If not, it will be a square piece. 4-jaws just makes more sense for us. And certainly the self-centering is an absolute again for us, because like I say, most of the pieces are going to be round anyway before we start turning them, either in bowl blank form or you've turned down your shape to hold in the chuck, and yeah, just that's just the way it's developed, 4-jaw self-centering. All right,
carry on.
Excellent. I just wanted to say hello to Mark as well. Mark was up here yesterday doing a little bit of filming with us, and that's an exciting video that we're going to put out for you next Tuesday with Steph, a little project that he's going to be, tutoring you over.
Tutoring, yes. Yeah, it's the next in the beginners series. He coped very well with teaching me. And I think that he might be a more patient teacher than Colwin.
Impressive. I'll second that. A lovely little project that they've done together. Nice. Am I allowed to say what the project is? Or we're going to hold that a secret?
I mean, you can say, yeah.
Yeah. So it's a lovely little ring box. Bearing in mind what day it's not. Is it the day?
No, it's the 13th.
Tuesday. 13th. So it's Valentine's, obviously, on the Wednesday. This is a nice little Valentine's gift. So look forward to that one next Tuesday. It was quite a nice, I enjoyed the day. Actually, I was behind the cameras this time, sort of watching them do it. It was quite a good bit of fun, giggling away all day. Well done, Mark. You made it through the day. Anyway, so that's O'Donnell jaws, deep grip jaws, pen jaws, and the E jaws we've gone through. So these, we've got a few others here. So, and I'm going to refer to my notes as to what I've got here, because I call them completely different things. We've got a nice set of A-jaws. Now I keep saying these are my favorite. That depends on what I'm making to what's my favorite, to be honest. And if you're doing a platter, you want something, if you want to do a recess in the platter, so nice stable base, then A-jaws are one of my favorites, because they've got this lovely big dovetail on the outside. But then you've got, if you want to do a smaller bowl with a dovetail, you've got this nice one on the inside. But they're a real solid jaw. There's some substance to that jaw. There's some thickness there. And if you're turning on a platter, they're going to be fairly big in diameter. That's really quite important. So I find them really stable jaws to use. And they're just really cool on that jaw. They work really well. A couple of other jaws. We've got a smaller dovetail. So if you're into the smaller pieces, so this is a tiny little dovetail jaw. So expanding into tiny little dovetailed recesses, you can see at the size of that jaw. But the center also goes down to zero. So you could hold small drill bits and things like that in there. It's another good way of being able to hold those bits. Or you've probably seen me before holding the little power sanding pads in the lathe. Perfect for that sort of thing. Ideal solution to holding small pieces on the lathe. And just before we look at the last one, let's do that other question.
Yeah, so we've just had a question in saying, hi, is there a chuck that would fit the Arundel K600? I think it requires a 24x3.
24x3. Email that question in to us. We'll have a look and see what's available, either by us or not. But yeah, just email that in because I need to research the thread as to what the old coding is on that thread. So yeah, email a question and we'll try and sort an answer out for
and
you.
And what's the email address again?
Yes, Steph, you tell everybody the email address.
Woodworking Wisdom. At axminstertools.com. It doesn't have a dot in it, does it?
No, it's just woodworkingwisdom@axminstertools.com.
I'll put it in the chat.
Lovely. Thank you. They were trying to test each other then. And lastly, one of the little gripper jaws. So in 114 and 100 speak, these are known as a Dove H. Okay, so this is the Dove H. And lovely little gripper. Everything's lovely and everything's my favorite. A real nice gripper section. So these are designed, these are teeth. These are designed to bite in and actually bruise the timber. They're teeth, they're biting in. So then that foot, that step, that tenon that you create then, or recess even, can then be taken away and cleaned up afterwards. But they give you a really, really secure holding because they're, or you imagine all that surface area with those different little serrations in there. So there's a huge amount of bite power there. So that's the jaw range of the new SK88 essential chuck. As Mark said, good way of keeping everything nice and rust free would be camellia oil. The other good thing will be getting in the workshop and using it often as well. That keeps everything nice and dry, nice and anti-rusted. And if you ever get to the point where you have got a bit of rust on the surface and you have to take it off, then something like web wrax and camellia is together works really well. That's a web wrax, possibly the gray is a nice fine version, which is an abrasive nylon, almost like an equivalent to wire wool. So that's quite a good way of taking it off. Take it apart to do that, of course. Don't need to take the chuck apart, but take the jaws off to clean them. You can just get in a little bit further. And a light spray of camellia oil. Any light spray, like I say, Teflon spray, dry lubricant, all of those sorts of things to spray over. That one's had a really good dose of dry lube. We've done this for photographs, and we sprayed and sprayed and sprayed just to get the right picture of the spray coming out properly. And it's really made it, it's really quite resistant to the rust. And I've been handling this for, days and days now, and it's still really, really good. So, yeah, that works. So let's just do a little project, and hopefully whilst I'm doing this project, we can get a few more questions in as well.
Mark wants to know who tidied up all the shavings.
I did that, Mark. Thank you.
It wasn't me, Mark.
Yes, no, I did that about 20 minutes ago.
I did all the hard work of making the shavings for you.
Yeah. They were good shavings as well.
Thank you. Expert tutoring.
Needless to say, I think Jason might be doing a little bit of tutoring now in the next couple of months coming.
He has mentioned it today that he's going to do one at some point. Right. We've just had a question come in. Sorry. Is the chuck available in the US?
Yes, it will be. Absolutely. So all through the regular dealers, they are looking at it now. And yeah, I don't have dates or anything like that.
It should be available from the Woodturning store soon. Yeah,
Woodturning store, Woodturning Wonders as well, I believe. I have to check on that one. But yes, it is coming to the US. All right, let me just expand my calipers. Obviously, I'm going to do... Oh, should I do a recess or shall I do a foot? I'm going to do recess, so I'm going to expand into this, and measure the chuck. I'm going to go with dividers, actually. I'm going to go with dividers and just take that chuck out just for the minute. Steph's all worried because she's noticed that the lead of the lathe is out. Don't worry, Steph.
You haven't plugged it in.
I'm on it. It's all good. It's all good.
As long as you're
Yeah, it's just for safety.
You forgot to get an extension, Nate. That's
No. Okay. No, I can just plug it in behind us. That's fine. Okay, pop that one back in. So I was thinking about going for a foot. I'm going to go for a recess.
Borders asked what lathe you're using, please.
This one is the little what's my number? I can't read my number. Hang on, Ward, I'll be right with you a minute. You're going to look at it for me?
I'll look it up for you. We've also had another question from Robert Richards saying, are there specific carriers for the jaw sets?
SK80 jaws will work. The mounting jaws will work on this one. I think there is another carrier available. Again, Steph, can you look that up for me? I've done a video on this particular lathe outside my workshop, my old workshop, going back about 3 years ago, and we used this one. We were all in the middle of that really difficult time, lockdown in COVID, and my sons were videoing me on my phone just using this, and we were turning something similar to this actually, but a slightly bigger bowl outside in the sunshine. So have a look back through the Woodworking Wisdom videos and you might be able to grab that one. Right, plug the lathe in, Steph, and then we'll be good to go. Yeah, that out of the way. I'm just going to keep this really, really simple. I've got a recess I'm going to create. So lathe speed to zero, turn the lathe on. And I'm thinking, you know, this is what we're in February now. So Christmas is not a completely distant thing. There's probably a lot of you that had or have been gifted or bought since Christmas your first lathe. And this is the sort of project you probably want to start with. Don't go big. So, you know, most people, when they get a lathe to start, they want to put the biggest blank of timber on that they can. And that's when you run into problems. You get big catches, you get put off the craft altogether. Keep small, keep on these smaller projects. They'll be much better for you. They'll look after you better. So this is the sort of size that I'm talking about. All right, Steph? Yes. Just while I'm sizing a tenon. There we go. I'll just cut that with the parting tool. I'm going to turn the lathe speed up a little bit. It's around about 1400 there. I'm not going to go overly deep with this one. There we go. That's fine. And then we'll remove that. I'll go with a slightly smaller bowl gouge to remove that. So I'm going to push away from that important edge. Just managed to eat a bit of shaving. There we are. Let's clean that up. So I'm going to go straight in there. Well, you know what we're going to go in with now. We're going to go in with the signature skew. Just a little gentle cut. Then I'm going to draw out. So I'm going to do a pull cut now and just draw out some of that timber just to start shaping. So using the bottom of the flute as my, or the bottom edge of the tool, so closing the flute over toward me, just going to drag. And because of the recess here, I don't want to go too narrow. So this is going to be a functional piece. It's going to sit and bed down really nicely on the lathe. So we're going to have a little rim on this one. So I'm going to come around with this convex curve So bevel rubbing now. So I've opened the flute to about 10 o'clock. And it's just bringing that shape around. Now, quite a long way. We're going to finish up with a little bead on the top. Just continue that shape over. Yeah, just a little sort of a cauldron shape of bowl. As I want to go with that, then we'll get a little back cut. There we go, and I'm just going to put a little series of lines in there. Just a little fun piece. Yes, Steph.
We've got a few questions, actually.
Oh, good.
Indeed.
I like questions.
As we've got Angling Coach asking, total newbie, but did you use both points or just a single point when you were marking the tenon? Or how do you centralise?
For this one, yeah. So when you're marking, you're hovering over centre point. What you don't want to be doing is getting this point any you know, too close to the timber. This is your cutting one, and this stays down on the tool rest. So this is your scribing cutter. That hovers, that scribes. The thing is, if you accidentally go right of center, everything on the right of center is traveling upwards, and then that's going to cause a problem for this one if it makes contact. That's why we only hover center rather than go over. And if you're unsure where center is, just do this with your pencil, because as soon as you turn the lathe on, you can pretty much see center. So just pop a little pencil dab on there, and that really helps you. It gives you a focal point to pinpoint the hover of your dividers over.
Lovely. Tony Funk is asking, will the chuck be available in Canada?
Yes, I know that.
Oh,
yes.
Where from?
Now I don't know that.
Oh.
I do. I get told all these people that are selling our products. So what we'll do, can we put that in the chat afterwards in this video so they can look back at it? Is that a possible thing?
I can put it in the description.
Right, yep, I'll do that.
Make a note you of know that.
Make a note of that, and we'll do that, yeah.
And then you'll know who our retailer is in Canada.
Yes.
Frank has asked, can you use a reducer from an M33 to fit another size lathe? If so, which do you recommend? We don't sell them anymore, do we?
We don't.
Sorry.
No. You can use one for the chuck. I don't like using them, because every time you join another thing is going to create a little error in some. So you will find that the chuck will start to move around and wobble unless very lucky. So I try and avoid them. But they're available in quite a few threads. Like I say, the 33, the 30, the inch 8, the 3/4, 16. So there's quite a few. The answer to your question is yes. We don't supply them. I would go direct as a recommendation.
Perfect. There's a few other comments, but I don't think you need to know them. Just mainly about your skew chisel.
Okay. Right. unscrew. I'm not going to sand just because you don't need to see me sanding through the grits. I would go from 100 all the way up to 400, potentially 600, depending on the timber. I don't have the dust extractor close at hand because I was just going to show you the chuck and the jaws. That was it. So let's say we've sanded. I would have probably put an oil finish on this one, a sanding thinner and wax maybe. But yeah, the reason I would go oil finish, I like the color that it brings. It does make the piece look very deep and rich.
We've just had another question come in. Actually, another two, sorry, just while you're chatting. Nope. Charles has asked, why are Axminster not making their chucks as quick release?
Because this is the way it's worked for years and the way we prefer. And if you made them quick release, that the mechanism for that would cost a huge amount more money than a scroll would as well. So that would be not the opposite of what we're trying to do with, certainly with this chuck anyway. The SK114s and the SK100s are born from a chuck called the Super Precision that we've done for years. And it was known to be probably the best chuck in the world. And so that's the pedigree it's coming from. That was always a scroll chuck. And based on engineering scroll chucks, actually. So that was a recipe that we've always gone with.
Yeah. Perfect. And Frederick's asked, I'm not sure if this is a question, but he said, when marking centers, I mark just off the center, so make a lighter colored spot easier to see.
Yeah. Good stuff. Right. I'm going to stick with a little quarter inch gouge. Blade speed back up. We'll look at skidding now. So when we're skidding, so skidding means it's not going to happen when I want it to.
I did it yesterday.
So skidding is when you go in, usually it's when you're doing the final cut on the outside of a bowl and the whole chisel moves this way. That would probably be because one of two things, your flute's facing too upright or your handle's too close to you when you go in, when you start that cut. So the first thing you need to do is bring your handle over the other side of the machine and then flute all the way over to 3 o'clock, start your cut. When the cut gets started, then you can put the flute back and push forward and swing around. Remember to swing around. Have a little bit more speed there. Now, this is aimed at all you beginners out there. We can carry on doing what we're doing here, but we'll end up being members of the funnel club fairly quickly. And that means going through the bottom of the bowl. We don't want that to happen, do we? Or you might do, you might want to make lampshades, but which are in at the moment. But if you don't want to make that happen, what we're going to do is cut down to just past halfway-ish. Stop the cut. Take out the bulk now. Shavings all over the place. So what I'm doing really is working on my first wall thickness here. So I'm going to keep going. Here we are. So first wall thickness is done. Now it's probably down around about 15 mils, about 5/8 wall thickness in depth. And we're around about 5 to 6 mils, so nearly quarter inch in thickness at the moment. And that's fine. Now we can start cutting across the bottom. So we're actually taking the depth away, but in control. So we know where everything is. Let's just have a quick look. see what we've got there. What I like to have at hand is a tool, a gouge called a bottom feeder. A bottom feeder is a gouge that has a lesser angle here, so maybe up to 60 degrees. But that means you can come around that bottom quite quickly without hitting the rim as you come around. This one's 55 degrees. It's working, actually, and I could do with making at least one more cut there on the bottom. So look how quickly that handle comes around. And what you don't want here is suddenly to see a big black hole. Maybe I should finish before I say this. A big black hole appear, meaning that you're actually gone too far. But because the way we've done this, we can start pinching for thickness now. You can even get a set of calipers in there if you want to. So we've got a nice round corner here, so I'm happy with that. We could go a little bit further. I'm not going to.
No. You're not going to share everybody your skills. Cut? I reckon do one more cut, Colwin Way.
Yeah. One more cut then. It's going to be a nice small one. And the other thing, as well as going too thin and going through the bottom, you can tear the bottom out. So just slow your cut down. When you get to that last little, say, quarter inch, I suppose, 6 mil, slow your cut down. So where the timber's running at its slowest point in the very, very center, you're not putting too much force on it. So you're actually tearing that grain out. So calm it down a little bit. Even back off and take a couple of cuts to finish the last little bit. That might work. Yes, Steph, fire away.
Yes. So Ward Wilson's asking what type of wood it is.
What wood? Oh, sorry.
Yeah. I know, I'm asking myself a question, Colwin.
It's ash. It's a nice piece of ash. Where can we? Where's the best place?
Three.
There we are. So it's a nice little shape. That one's just a little cauldron sort of shape. Like a sweet little bowl to match the chuck. Nice sweet little.
A nice little toffee dish.
There you go, a little toffee dish, a little recess in the back. And when you're starting out, when you're a beginner, recesses just seem to be a little bit more stable. A bowl of this size using a tenon is fine, and you can put a good amount of pressure in. But I have seen tenons in the beginner stages, because the likelihood of creating catches and dig-ins is more prolific. You will get a few more, then, you know, they can split away, where it's a lot harder. It's a wider surface area on a recess. So I would certainly start with a recess. As you progress through your turning, you will want to do things like take all hold points away, so there's no no visible signs of being held, and that will require you doing a tenon. So those will be things to progress on to after you've learned to use the gouge nicely. But there we are, not sanded. That needs a bit of a sand, which I can still do that because we've got a recess there. I can even mount it, expand the button jaws on it, and sand the back before I then turn it over. So there's lots of options with that one. Yes, Steph.
Lovely. And Angling Coach has said, does the noise of the cut help you determine the depth?
It does. It definitely does. As my turning sort of career is developed, I find now, especially when I'm bowl turning, that I need to wear ear protection a lot more, and always beside me is a set of those. If I was doing a bigger piece, they would be on, but you're dead right. As you go through and get closer to the center, you can hear those differences in thickness from the side to the very middle. It is a heart-stopping moment when you start hearing the tinniness, when it starts to get really, really thin on the bottom. But yeah, you will pick that up. Yeah.
Brilliant. And Tattoo Man has asked, what is the price of the tool? I think if he means the chuck, then the price of the kit is in the UK is £169.98.
Current price as of today's date.
Yes. And as of today's date, the chuck on its own, so the body only, is £129.98 as of today.
As of today. Have a look on the website. Yeah, all the different kit variations and things like that will be there as well. obviously in your country of purchasing, have a look at their website. So woodturningstore.com and Woodturning Wonders and those other dealers, which we will put up after we've finished going live. Yeah.
And I've just put a link to our website page for the SK88 in the chat.
Well done. Have you done this lathe?
I award? Have, yes.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. My apologies for my dodgy memory. And the mountain jaws. Well done. Well done. Lovely. Well, any more questions?
No, that's it. That was
a really
so
quick
far.
One today, wasn't it?
Yeah, you've done well.
I don't know. I say it's quick. I have no idea what time it is. Oh, we get to about 22. About 40 minutes.
Oh, he meant the lathe.
The name of this lathe or the price of this
lathe. The price of the lathe.
Have you got that?
Yeah.
You put the link in for us?
I have popped the link in earlier. I've got to type it in now.
Lovely. Look, remember what I said. If everybody like what you see, give us a thumbs up. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Hit the notifications button to be told when we're doing another Woodworking Wisdom. Don't forget next week, the gentleman woodturner, Mark Beckett, is going to be teaching Steph, or the nicknamer Super Steph now, how to turn a little ring box for Valentine's. So make sure you stick by for that one. I'm going to just hang on a little bit while Steph is putting in those other details. All right, Steph, give me the nod when you're ready.
I've just put the lathe in again for the chat.
Lovely. Any questions you have, you know where we are. Just give us an email, drop us a line, or at any of the Woodworking Wisdoms, the live ones, just give us a save your questions up for those, because we love questions. Personally, love the jeopardy of live. And in a few weeks' time, I think we're going into March, we're going to be doing a session where you tell us what you want made and we'll make it live on the spot. So that's an exciting one, for certainly for me. No Chinese boxes, anybody, or no Weeble Wobbles, please.
I love a Weeble Wobble.
No.
Sorry, Tattoo Man has just asked very quickly, is that a good starting lathe?
That is. I mean, so a real can of worms when it comes to starting lathe, because it depends on so many factors, including what room you have, what you want to spend, what you want to end up doing, all of those sorts of things. And I always like to speak to the person direct and see what their situation is. I would say starting lathes, if you're going to look at a bench top, this is a good option. If you can go a bit bigger and you want to do bigger things, then the 355 or the 368 if you want to start with a floor standing machine. So they're all aimed at beginner turners, hobby turners, people with their own small workshop, really. Any of the workshop range is. This is a good variable speed machine. You can see how I was using that variable speed through it there. So we've got the start-stop, the variable speed, plus you've got a couple of belt settings as well. So for the torque and the high range, high and low range. So you've got all that available. Another question.
Angling Coach, sorry, they're all coming in all at the last second.
Like
Angling Coach has just asked, do you wood turning courses? I have put a link to your website courses page.
Thank you.
But just in case you want to plug it shamelessly.
Yes, we do. Well, I do wood turning courses up at the new venue up at Miller's Farm Shop in Kilmington. And go to my website, colwinwaywoodturner.com, and you'll see all the available dates that are there. And they have been tremendously well supported. We're getting to the point of being sold out for 2024, so I do apologize for that, but I'll be putting dates up for next year and near Christmas very, very soon. So have a look anyway. There might be something that you haven't thought of that might be available. So yeah, colwinwaywoodturner.com. Colwin, colwin, not the yn.
I put the link in the chat.
Thank you, mate. Thank you. Lovely. Well, thank you ever so much for joining me and Steph this time. Don't forget, next week it's Steph and Mark. And Jason is, what's Jason doing this week? I see him busying away in the workshop.
I believe Jason's got a pre-record coming out this week. He's making a routed lamp, which is very intriguing.
Excellent.
Looks lovely.
We'll stop by and have a look at that one. So see you again. I'll be back in a couple of weeks' time, but next week was Mark and herself, Super Steph.
Super Steph.
See you, everybody. Thanks for dropping by.
Bye.